对对对，那我这边其实就主要是分partnership啦，那里面就包含说协助整个新创商业圈里面的各个成员，包含企业，包含加速器，包含新创 talent， 还有甚至还有一些国际伙伴的部分，大家能够有好的平台可以互相的交流，那能够找到彼此要的资源，那大家投资人刚刚都在讲。对，那所以我们这边就是负责，特别就是负责协助这些单位，他们的不同 program 都能够杠杆到我们这个平台，都能在这个地方能够找到他们所需要的一些适合的伙伴。那当然最后目标是希望新创能够成功啦，那也希望台湾的整个新创的 community 还有新创生态圈都能够有更蓬勃的发展。对，因为我们认为说新创 community 基本上是创办人之间的愿望要能够互相帮忙。那新创生态圈是我刚刚讲的一大堆企业啦、投资这些都能够进来帮忙新创，对，所以我们里面其实让蛮多不同的部门来协助这件事情发生啦。那科技部自己这边，就我们这个团队主要在做，主要是两个，一个是 outbound， 就是协助台湾团队走出去国外，那包含了带团去 CES 啦，送团队去西谷的加速器发展，协助他们在那边连接成长，主要是 outbound 部分。那 inbound 部分就是在 TTA 我们做场域空间管理。做加速器引进的部分，来协助加速器在这边去落地生根，还有协助团队去做一些跟企业这边的链接。对，所以我们自己的团队主要就是做一些英镑、澳镑部分，那还有当然配合科技部做一些，比如国内的展会啦，就是协助科技部去做一些比较策略化，是像调研的部分，我们之前跟那个 Star 去弄。是去做一些台湾的调研，
知道那个很有意思，对，
对，很有意思。那其实我们也是陆陆续续接触到蛮多不同的伙伴都在做类似，国际伙伴都在做类似这种生态圈调研。那每个人的领导力可能不太一样。那比如我们最近也跟 Daystar 的下面他们会做一个伙伴，叫做那个那叫什么？他们的那个调研是那个
Baber，
对，从法国来的 Baber， 对 Baber， 他们比较是从。所谓的人和人之间的 network 的角度来做，他希望能看到就是说，他们的逻辑是说，生态圈要好的话，基本上政府角色不能太强。
是。
对，他们那时候有就是把人和人之间的关系 map 出来，说如果说都是 map 到同一个人或同一个组织的话，其实是反而是不好。
一个民族制的观点了、
啊。对，那希望是这个是大家互相帮忙，对，他们其实看到希望能做这个，所以我们也做类似，也会做类似的事情。那我们从现在到下半年其实有几个 initiative， 那跟这个也会有相关。一个是我们跟里面一个专门做健康医疗加速器叫医加速器，
是
他们在做一个算是 health for all 的一个 initiative。那也是算是有点配合卫福部的那个台湾 Can Help， 那 health for all 嘛。那我们这边有很多健康医疗相关的新创，那也有一些相关医院的一些公费 partner 的一些资源。那两个部分，一个是台湾的医院其实现在的算是 bandwidth 还蛮够的，
对、啊、
所以我们会希望就是国外有一些好的医疗团队，他可以来台湾做一些验证，因为国外的医院现在都没有空做这种事情。对，所以一个是我们会去开在下半年规划，就是说国外的健康医疗团队来台湾的，跟台湾的医院
做特别的题目吗？
其实有点像是我们哦，因为我们现在主要的是秀兰跟北医，
对，
那秀兰跟北医，那秀兰当然现在有做微创的东西嘛。
对啊，
那北医其实数位医疗这块其实发展非常强，
对，
强，对，所以大家也会从这两个角度去着手。那北医的部分又特别在于，就是说台湾这边有健保资料库相关的一些 data，
就精准健康嘛，
对，所以精准健康这些市场就是这两个题目，大家会是跟北医。
是的，
这个
我们这边除了 COVID 的检体很缺，其他大概。
对，那另外一条说，你们其实也是包含很多，希望那些里面的新创团队，如果有些就是跟 COVID-19 相关的防疫啊，或者监测相关的技术，也都能够希望利用这个平台去介绍给更多国外的伙伴，让他们知道。那同时，就国外的好的技术，包括像这次或者这样的团队，好的技术可以跟政府有些合作的话，实际上我们就希望利用这样的平台去促成。
对啊。
那Health for All 这个主题比较是在 healthcare 跟健康医疗相关，
是。
那我们会希望这样子的一个概念能够往更大的方向、更多不同的产业走。所以我们现在也在规划一个名字还是暂定啊，叫做 Innovation for All。
很好啊。
Innovation for All 基本上就是说，希望未来就是我们能够定期的去抠一些企业进来，那针对他们看到，不管是因为是 COVID-19， 像商业上、生活上，或者是金融上，或者是像我们餐饮业等等，都遇到很多其实潜在的挑战。那这些企业是不是能够正常看到大企业，针对他们看到这些挑战，也去专提出一些他们希望新创生态圈能够一起进来解决的问题。那我们会利用这样子的一个算是平台去做一些 corporate 的征集，还有 staff 的征集。那希望在年底的时候也
因为你们有用过发挥就是万用 logo 吗？
目前还没有。
目前还没有。
要说我有，对
对对对。
但是你到底是误会是天大误会。
对，我相当理解，我相当理解，所以再问一下。
对那其实这个，
其实我们参展的时候有用过。
我们参展，我们企业参展都会放的。误会是天大误会，会帮我们协调好，对，我们就不用参展，那就告诉我们放在哪就好了。
对，讲话非常有技巧。OK， 好。
是，
非常好，OK， 好啊。那所以我们今天是先听那个 Max 的那个部分，
请 Max 稍微介绍，然后就我们就讲这
些。哎，对，
稍微介绍一下。那基本上今天的 agenda 会是，10:10会有一个 startup coin 进来，从旧金山叫 Nvidia， 然后10:30，因为我们是当时跟Richard Jarry 这边是提出，那就各20分钟，因为时间有限嘛。那如果真的就是对 startup 这边有更想要更深入了解，可能之后可以再
就没问题了，因为我们也是在做节目，所以也是给我们的观众，如果有兴趣的话，他们也可以直接 reach out。
OK OK， 对，因为可能是那个就是时差关系，所以就是我们就先跑这一个小时。
好啊好啊，
对啊对啊。那基本上啊 ，Max 不知道有没有来过，就是我们的任何活动，就是我们在台湾的活动，其实从2015年创立的时候，然后2016年开始正式在，当时是在就是产发局，然后 CIT 那边，然后有办公室。那
是
2018年，对，是2018年年底的正式进驻到台湾这边，所以等于我们在台北其实是两个分部。那Max。就是基本上就是 mobile， 所以呢，在台湾主要是互联网，但其实我们的母公司是 SOSB， 对，所以其实这两间公司都是被我们的就是这个资金去投资过的公司。
OK，
所以我们所有的公司基本上这概念就是他们都是 pre investment， 所以我们所有的公司一定都是有先经过投资才会进入到我们的项目。
所以你们这个项目，它这个 cohort 中间，你们会去策展吗？还是没有？
也会，就是当然这些生态圈的运营啊，这些都会做。
对，
那当然以加速器的成分，因为毕竟我们是比较早期进来台湾，那虽然我们没有就是只专注在台湾情况，但其实主要还是以跨境的动作来做。
对吧？对吧？所以你的策展是以就是 cross jurisdiction 的概念。
对，我们其实更多的是以国际参展。
了解了解。
对，那台湾比较像是我们在这里做一些 community event。
Right.
对，因为毕竟我们的 network 是cross 总共有7个 sector 嘛。台湾这个分布是以互联网，那大部分是从美欧的新创，那这几年可能比较多东南亚、印度新创，那我们把它就跨境大到就整个亚洲的亚太市场。对，那其他的分布包括在纽约啊、伦敦啊、都柏林啊，甚至爱尔兰，然后今年去年在东京也开了新的办公室。那中国的话也有4-5个城市，对，都有不同的加速器，可能都
会在。我去泰国 TechSource 的时候，好像有听过。
对，
听过你们的介绍。
我之前有我们团队有遇到，因为那时候在另外一个参展，所以
那
2019年的 TechSource 没有去。
对对对对，就是那个什么 Mobile First 的一个 Curation 啊。
对对，没错。对，所以我们其实就是整个资金的一环啊，当然其他还有我们硬体啦，然后Biotech 啊 ，Food Tech， 对，然后所以。主要是我们还是希望，因为最近就是 coronavirus 的关系，那我们其实跟很多不同的生态圈伙伴都在希望可以克一些我们自己 startup 已经有在做的，然后甚至可能跟不管是政府机关或是一些企业有在做一些美合，那也希望可以把
信用啊，
把这些东西带回来这里。
OK，
对，那就像刚刚 Rich 提到我们可能比较愿在 Mouse。比较不是针对就是那么直接的是这种生技医疗相关的协助，那可能比较是整个 ecosystem， 例如说可能做 people movement 啦，可能做一些稍微电子医疗的平台啦，然后或是一些就是促进大家整个就是优化生活啦的这样的平台，那所以比较像是其他的就是技术的结合，那看可以怎么样去帮助现在所有可能每个政府已经在进行的一些 initiative。对，那基本上这两个公司，第一个叫做 Loha Data， 它其实是就是从矽谷出身的，那整个团队都是由 Stanford 的 PhD 毕业的一些工程师，然后包括 founder。那他们其实如果以就是 government tech 这个 sector， 他们一开始的定位其实还是比较偏 big data。People intelligence 这样子的方向，因为它等于就是收集所有的 geographic 的 data。对，那因为我们自己的生态圈，因为我们有1000多个 portfolio 嘛，所以它跟我们的合作方式除了投资 以外，还有一个特点是它其实、也跟我们很多公司是做就是 data 上面的 exchange， 对，所以它其实算是我们 Swarm Portfolio 算就是 top winner 之一这样子，因为它除了跟我们就是有今天上投资的合作，它也间接可以就是因为我们可以就是生态圈 supporter 的角度，让它也去带到我们所有只要是有mobile 啦或是 SDK API 任何的 data 可以让它去做运用。所以它现在已经横跨大概1400多个国家。
它的运用是那个 raw data analysis， 它也做 prediction 相关的 TNL。
对，所以基本上它就是，好，例如说从 mobile 好了最简单的测取方式，它就是你只要 integrate 个 SDK，对，它就可以了解整个 people movement people 的一些 behavior。
我一说是往后的 analytic。
哦，也有，所以还可以做 reseller，
自己做。
对，就是跟企业的话，例如说可能啊，你可以跟车厂啦，你可以跟一些 big agent 啦，对，然后就是各种。
就他不 depend on 他的下游了，他自己就可以去。
对，他就是等于说把这些 bucket list 结合起来，然后看他怎么再去 reference。对，那最近的 coronavirus， 它基本上就是跟先从的旧金山政府开始，就是市政府啦，还有纽约州政府，然后先从美国开始cook。那基本上现在大概有6-7个国家，就是之前一些 detail 有先 share 给你们。那基本上可能比较严重的国家包括欧洲啊、西班牙啦、意大利啊这样的国家，他们先开始做这些 application。那当然台湾其实已经有非常多我觉得成功的案例在跑，所以我觉得也是看看。
前提了，不知道怎么办。
对，那我
有些前提没有新的。
唯一的话就是现在我们主要是中文为主嘛，是吗？对，所以可能 maybe 他们可以协助到更多，就是说可能跨境啊，或是之后如果真的 travel ban 就是 release 的时候，这些 traveler 我们要怎么去做 track？
traveler 来这边还是他们飞以前会快筛来这边会 rapid test，
当然，
如果是 high risk area 还是 quarantine，
对，
那所以这些跟这个 app level 的关系。我不是在 challenge 你，我只是 matter of fact 就是觉得关系不大，这是我比较疑惑的一点。
我觉得他主要是做预防的动作啦，就是他现在跟其他以我所知啦，他待会会有更详细介绍，他是有一些 prevention 的动作说，说 OK， 现在他们的可能 travel ban 的，因为之前在美欧市场，可能他们还没有在一开始还没有真的做到这些机制的时候，他可以先有一个 warning。那当然，这个怎么采纳措施，怎么去执行，还是看他们怎么协调，但他起码可以做到，就是先 prevent 说 OK 会有哪些 travel 过来，那他们的那个 risk 的 rating 在哪边？对，主要是这些。
然后，对，因为我们都全部就是请到旅馆去14天，我们确定他们的
risk 是 compulsory。
对，it's not like， 其实没有你去，我们每天还是给你就是3块美金，当然。
对。
就是如果就是跑掉的话，那就要付1000个人的费。
对。对，那我觉得可能是一款，因为我觉得我们的 quarantine 这块已经做的比其他国家确实蛮多，可能比较是后期的追踪，就是例如说他有一些case study， 就是说他可能去追踪这些即使有一些国家是 lockdown， 他可能还是会有几天是可以出来。
对，如果从量上的时候，这个是很有效，就好比像说什么车牌号码分流、身份证尾码分流这种事。
对，那他可以跟店家跟因为他原本的这 data 本来就是从这些所有的 brand 啊这些 merchant 去拿到的 data， 对，所以他可能可以 track 说例如说在 coronavirus 之前，他可以 track 说我可能平常就喜欢喝星巴克，好了，我在可能 Palo Alto area 喝的几率比在 Cupertino 还要多，他可以 track 说他从这边跟店家之间去联系，他们可能movement 的frequency， 然后
这个 affinity cohort 这个
对，然后 pharmacy 它也有做合作，可能所有的 supply 它什么时候需要赶快再补充这些供给，对，它可以先做到一个就是事前告知的动作，对。那我觉得这些细节当然可能还是要看它怎么可以 apply 到这边了，因为我觉得每个国家实施的方向不太一样。
我目前脑里一个场景都没有，所以但是我不是否定它，所以那待会我就是 listen with an open mind。
Sure。对，就是我觉得可能看看有没有什么 match。或是有没有什么 pain point 是他们还可以帮忙解决这样子。那另外一间公司叫 Several Cups， 他们其实来自印度，比较特别。对，我们其实这两年投资了将近40-50间印度公司。对，就是台湾好像还比较少，对，因为毕竟它有点像是我们其实尽量不提说它是下一个中国，因为其实整个生态圈很不一样嘛。但是当然如果以市场的幅度，它的确它整个腹地啦，还有整个 market size 是。 绝对可以可比的。那当然它现在很多比较技术的资源engineer 资源也都还没有被开发，所以我们也是看到很多潜在的，尤其是可能从美欧就是海归回去印度的这些人才，他们想要在 home market 先做起来，然后再达到海外，那我们就是帮他做达到海外的这个工作。
对，他就是什么1999这种东西，就外面三
有这些我基本的资料我们有，就是 share 给这些团队，但有一些资料还是中文，所以可能他们还没有到完全理会，但他大概也知道。那我觉得印度政府其实是还蛮localized 到不同的州政府跟 city， 因为腹地很大嘛，所以其实他们一个 solution 或是像一个 app 一个 platform， 可能你在 Gurgaon 有了，可是在Bangalore Delhi 都还没有被
对啊，就他们地方自治程度很高。
对对对，所以他们也是因为他们本来就是 government tax 一家，原本是就是做所有跟政府相关，有任何的需要做不管是人才培训啊，或是中间的一些这种 corporate 那 internal 的这种沟通，对对。那当然 coronavirus 就是也是所有印度州政府都在实施的都希望可以再更优化的平台。那他们就是等于是 integrate 他们原本就有的，包括 chatbot 啊，包括一些对 supply tracking 啊这些东西，就是 implement 到所有已经现有的系统当中，比较像是这样。
实际上有 deploy 了吗？
有，他现在主要因为毕竟是他 base 在印度，所以他毕竟现在还是会以 application 会是以印度为主，但他当然现在也在把这个，因为他其实已经克服了十几个 language， 所以
说着
他就进来，
说着说着他又不见了，
对，待会可以跟他聊。他现在除了跟印度也有跟像UN 的 woman 已经有在 application 做一些东西。
Hello.
Can you see us?
Hello, Ashish. Can you see us?
Is the sound?
The sound.
What? Okay,
okay. 你可能要把那个从 HDMI 出来。
好，等一下。
从右边，因为没从那个 handout 那三个点，这三个点
右边。
好。
对，然后一个音讯。
对，设定
。把它从那个改成那个，
改成那个改，麦克风不用改，那个喇叭。后面第二
显示器，哎，显示。
或者你就先用你的喇叭也可以。
对，
就
看起来
最上面的已经是了，所以你是用第二个，你是用
这个吗？
对 ，OS 这个，好，完成。Okay, would you like to say something? So we can know what your sound is working.
Hey. 嗯，对了，我。
没有，他没有声音。就是我
这个
不能
开，欢迎来看
看。Are you serious?
你看这个测试。
你的声音没有出来。
没有，声音没有出来。那你再看一下试
试。He said he can hear us.
Here we go.
Okay, awesome.
I think it's connection speed. It's not anything else. It's probably connection speed. 我们这边有，
你
看我们写吗？
你是用这边的 WiFi 吗？
连不到。
你是用手机的？
对啊。
你把那个
手机应该就
你把 WiFi 关掉好了，你把那个 VPN 关掉。
如果你有 Internet port 的话，我们也有 Internet。
好咯。
看它画面这个流畅度，其实应该
或者是
应该是没问题。
对，
应该是我就不要晃好了。
好，不要晃。
对。
OK。
OK。
要 try again， try to say something again。
Yeah. So we see you now. In upright position now. So it's all good.
Hi, Ashish. Can you hear us now?
I don't think so.
No.
I think you can hear.
刚不就听到，怎么又断掉？
哎，你说
你的麦克风是有的，
我的麦克风
他那边有在闪啊。
它的也是开的，吧？
对，你现在开始收
在收，
现在是用，
应该是都有在收，因为它有
在
闪。
对，没错。 错没错，你的喇叭是好的，
喇叭也是 OK 的，
喇叭是好的，
所以
是麦克风也是好的，
麦克风也是
你看那个 audio volume 就知道。
嗯，他没有办法。
No。
No？ 对，他问他是不是 audible？ 当然他是啊。we can hear you, but apparently you cannot hear us. 可以问他要不要把耳机先 drop 下来，或者是改他的输出到电脑。
Yeah, I asked him to change his network. He said he's quite.
Yes.
We can hear you just fine, but apparently you cannot hear us.
Yes, I can hear you.
Oh, okay, all right.
Hi, there are three of you now.
Wow, I got it. Sweet.
Okay.
Can you hear us, Claire?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, please.
Okay, so for the time being, we have limited time. I have briefly talked about your current solutions. You're in India or you're in the UN and some other countries. So if you want to just talk through your demo quickly, the Audrey here.
Can everyone see my screen now?
Yes.
I've seen your website. So you can assume I've read everything on your website. And then just focus on the part that you would like to highlight.
So we are several cultures to pick up augmentation as part of the development.For facilitating the communication between government and political leadership. And considering the current situation, we have developed a coordinating meeting before. And so I'll just give them a quick
我觉得把那个 audio 把那个 video 关掉好了。
video 关掉，我们的 video 关掉。
看他要不要用。
用。
最近跟这个团队都是用，也是用 Google Meet 都没有问题。
不是，是他那边的
video。
对。
Ashish, can you turn off your camera right now so we could just only see your screen?
Yes, let's see if
that's
fine.
Yeah.
All right, yeah.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Please proceed.
Okay, thank you. So the main objective for us has been to.Facilitate direct communication between government bodies and citizens and in the selected world as well. Most of the communication that we have seen has been one-way communication, either through media, either through the news channels, or either through the digital trend. So we came up with this chatbot for facilitating that two-way communication, especially during the COVID of this time. So out of all the functions, there are some key highlights that I will focus on.The first is shared information with citizens who offer intermeasures, the symptoms of how people can understand coronavirus, the members, and some rules and rules. In terms of citizen request, the key focus area for us in India has been to facilitate all the citizen requests, this time in terms of maybe availability of foods, availability of groceries, medicine, mobile ATMs.Or any other citizen request. So, India has been in lockdown for the past 50 days, and I think it will continue for the next 50 days as well. So, this was one of the primary modules that we had prepared. Apart from that, in order to keep the headline numbers free for more important communication, we developed an FAQ service on the chatbot which can facilitate.Automated conversation in terms of the citizen queries related to the coronavirus, related to the treatment, or related to them being able to travel, either for essential services, and things like that. In terms of the community model of the chatbot, we facilitate any type of complaint which may be, which may be related to some breaking some laws related to the lockdown, maybe some suggestions from the citizens in terms of the joint services, which are initiatives can be taken by the government authority, and also certain feedback on which initiatives are already in place so that those can be improved.
Sorry to interrupt,
Ashish,
do you want to put on your presentation mode? So we can see your PowerPoint more clearly.
We're at the moment seeing only your page.
Cover page.
Yeah, I'm not sure if it's the video conference by technical issues.
这边的。
you want to click on the presentation mode so we can see a full screen.
It's fine. I mean, we can see just fine like this if you prefer. It's just if you go to the corresponding page, that makes your presentation like more contextual, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay, is it
visible
now? No, it's fine. You don't have to go to a presentation.
Yeah,
mode.
I mean, that's to you, but just, it will be more full screen.
Yeah. No, the font is fine. We can see the font. It's fine. Yeah, it's fine. Of course.
Okay, there we go. Because it's a bit distant.
I don't think that works.
Okay, so should I come in?
Yeah,
this is Google Meet. It doesn't capture full screen.
Please go on.
Just go through the slides.
This self-assessment scanner is rendered by us for those individuals who think they might have the disease, and they can just talk to the chatbot in an automated fashion. The chatbot will ask them some questions related to their health, the symptoms that they are showing, and based upon that, according to the guidelines of our health ministry and WHO, the chatbot will not give them any things for integrity-wise, but they will give them an idea of their risk level, and depending on their risk level, they can take some action. It can be staying at home, it can be observing their symptoms for the next 3 to 4 days, or it may be directly contacting the family's health member and asking for medical help. One more thing that has happened in the past 2-3 weeks is that wherever there are cases reported, a lot of citizens are putting up sanitization requests so that there is some sort of information along with location that can be sent to the government authority. So the municipal bodies can then send their team members along with equipment for sanitization of that particular neighborhood, building, or society. It is very necessary for some individuals to travel even during the lockdown period. These are people involved in essential services like healthcare, police authorities, or maybe other government officials. And then there are cases in which citizens also need to travel, for example, if they want to go to the hospital for some urgent matters. So in such cases, the government is allowing them to travel if they have an e-pass issued to them. So many of them had it on websites, many of them had their mobile applications. But then the problem was for the citizen to find it on Google the right thing, and then maybe downloading that particular app. So what we did was we added this module to the chatbot itself so for the citizens to apply for e-pass. Then the last fun module of the chatbot is basically presented in the dashboard and a daily tracker, wherein the numbers are being written to people from the organization of the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs in India. And for the daily tracker, the backend system of the chatbot can be integrated with any API for them to showcase the details of the in their area. The chatbot also displays some sort of information on testing centers which are nearby for your citizens so that they have the set of information required to take the family members for testing. So now I would request if there are any questions or if there are any doubts that I can clarify. I have included some screenshots. and I would be happy to share the link as well. We can deploy this chatbot over any social media platform, website, and whatever platform that we have.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the presentation. That was very helpful. My only question is that so the self-assessment scanner, if someone who doesn't like to type or someone who doesn't type very well, would it be possible to switch it to a kind of voice assistant-like mode where the bot prompts the person to answer the questions via voice or via other modalities that is not the kind of selection and typing as you were suggesting? Or do you suggest use the built-in universal access utilities in a mobile phone instead?
Okay, so there are two things here. In the chatbot, we want to cater to all types of citizens. So there are two types of users. One who have very specific doubts or queries, so what they will come to the chatbot, and just after putting get started, they will type in their exact specific question. So the chatbot has NLP and AI capabilities, and it will be answering them the answer that they're looking for. But in case of citizens or users who don't know who the chatbot is and what the services they can provide, they can scroll to the balance. In terms of voice assistance, we cannot offer them on platforms like Facebook and WhatsApp because there are certain limitations, but it can be done over there. And our voice assistants can be made to be deployed on platforms or into this system and on WhatsApp.
I see, thank you. That's very helpful. Do you have any questions for me?
So basically, actually, can you talk more about what is your chatbot now applying to? Like, I think mostly are still from Facebook. And since for Facebook in India, yes, it's one of the largest audience who use it. But for other countries, are you implemented in other services as well?
Yes, so I was doing some research. I remember that Taiwan CDC has made a chatbot online. CoFax, which was initiated by CEO, who also launched the chatbot online. So similarly for us, that was the same way. Our chatbots are developed on our conversation to our platform, and the integration can be done with any social media platform that has a chat feature. So yes, I think LINE would be the preferred in Taiwan, but that is only the website.
Right, so is this any...
Have you built a Telegram adapter?
Telegram,
so have you actually deployed it to Telegram?
Yes. We have deployed on Telegram, WhatsApp, Facebook, Google systems, mobile applications.
Is there a Telegram ID of your bot that I can chat now?
No, I can facilitate a demo link to be sent to you.
Okay, that will be highly helpful. I personally, before being the digital minister, worked with the Siri team for 6 years, and so on internationalization of chatbots, and we had to hire a lot of poets in different languages to make sure that the communication, the context of conversation carries on flawlessly, especially in voice assistant mode, which is very different from the text mode. So if you have a Telegram, that may be a good entry point, because a lot of brands in Taiwan are now hedging on Telegram because LINE charges them too much. And it's an open source platform, so at least the initial prototype, it shouldn't cost you too much if you already have a talent brain adapter. But then a lot of the demo, I mean, it's not about passing the Turing test, it's about providing useful guidelines to people. And so I would highly appreciate if you do have a Telegram chatbot that you can point me with. It could be about self-assessment, or it could be other aspects of coronavirus, about frontline medical workers and things like that. And I'm happy to just try it out myself. And there's also a website, you can type it in, cohack.tw, cohack.tw. Would you like to type it to the chat? Cohack.tw.
Okay. 那你打在那个圈给他。
对啊，还是。
Yeah, so the Cohack website is basically like if you have a English version of the website ready on your browser, you can read through the topics, and I think there's a few topics that may be pertinent for your ideas to join. Specifically, for example, how to visualize the communication about epidemiology and the current situation of the coronavirus. That's section 6. And there's also in section 3 a lot of ask about open source ways for people in vulnerable groups to find education materials as well as support, both mentally and also material. And these seems like to work quite well with your existing self-assessment scanner framework. So if you have a 3-minute demo or something, I would suggest that if you already have, I'm not asking you to do extra work, but cohack.tw ends today. So if you have something ready that's a 3-minute video in English, I would highly encourage you to just put it and upload it to the Cohack website, because we will have experts from Taiwan and also from the US, because this is a US-Taiwan joint statement that looks at all the coronavirus IT solutions. And so even if, because in Taiwan we're almost done with coronavirus now, that your application is of some use, I guess, but not a lot of use, it may be good for the US counterparts through parts of the judging panel to become aware of your business. And if there's a live demo on Telegram or on other like Facebook or channels, it would be good to include it in the 3-minute video, so that we make sure that all the experts from the US and Taiwan see the capability of your work. So that's my only concrete action item. If you send me the Telegram bot, I'm happy to give it a deeper try, because there's a very limited information we can get from this kind of presentation. But just trying out the bot for 15 minutes, and I'll be able to get more.
Definitely, that will be a good feedback for us. And as far as the website is concerned, we will definitely be doing that. We also have another solution that we will be doing for the time limitation, but we will definitely share that as well for your person.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot for your time.
Cheers.
Sorry for the technical glitches.
Thank you,
Ashish.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, take care.
Hi.
Bye.
I think just add a little bit. They did show on their chatbot in Telegram, WhatsApp, and Facebook before. He just told me his network is probably not that available to share the chatbot over the Google product.
So we'll
definitely send to you and Chelsea later just for more look. And so I think what is the difference actually from the Cohack initiative with is it an additional initiative that you were working with the US government so far, or is also connected?
No, it's a hackathon.
Okay.
So it's a 1-week hackathon.
Right.
Then we ask for solutions from all over the world about the present needs of including the US, but if the US needs it, then chances are other countries need it just to
So it's just
more or less
it's just between US and Taiwan, but it could be applied to
any team can join.
Right.
So it's just the top issues are being determined by a online survey with US and Taiwan seat questions. But other countries are welcome to join as well. And now we've settled on the set of questions in six categories that we want to tackle.
Okay.
Anyone can just upload a 3-minute video and along right. with the technology that they promise to work with the government. The only requirement is that the government do adapt it, like the US government, our government.
Right, right.
We do ask for a copy of the source code because it needs to run on sensitive data on government priorities.
Sure.
But other than that, it's a free hackathon.
Right, yeah. Right. Okay, so it could be in other markets as well.
It's today.
Yeah. Right, right. Well, I mean, yeah, I mean, there will be maybe more
hackathons,
but...
Yeah, there's a presidential hackathon as well.
Yeah, yeah, and I think, you know, if any, is that going to be connected to any Taiwan, like, local initiatives?
Yeah, if you win the COHAC or you win the presidential hackathon, we are committed to adapt your solution and start adopting it as civic tech into tech.
Right.
The Presidential Hackathon Award is literally the president handing you a trophy that's a projector and projects a presidential promise that your idea will be used next year.
Okay.
Okay, so we have the next person.
Yeah, so this is Elon.
Hi, greetings.
Hello.
Hey, good morning.
Can you hear us? Hey, okay, awesome.
Is the sound getting through?
Perfect connection.
Yeah, right there.
Okay, excellent.
So are we waiting for Abu as well?
I'm waiting for also expecting Abu and Jesse.
Yeah, so Jesse here. Hello. Hi, so you're calling from Singapore, right?
Yeah, right.
Okay, so we're waiting for Apu, which is so he's the BD director, and Apu will be dealing from San Francisco.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, so maybe give one more minute. Okay, awesome.
30 seconds.
There you go. Hey, Apu, how are you?
Good morning.
You're nighttime.
This is Audrey.
So, in the room, you'll see me, Zhao Yu, and Richard, who I met from China Tech Arena, and Audrey Tong, the Prime Minister of Taiwan.
Greetings.
Great, so here we go. So, off to you, Apu.
Okay, Jesse, do you want to sit down?
Yeah, so if you want to share your slide as mentioned, feel free to share the screen as soon as the connection is available.
Okay, and I can
walk through
the
data
and the data
that you have in the initiative. Yeah, so again, we have around 20 minutes, so I think we'll just be focused on especially your coronavirus initiative, the data for health part. And then for City Dash is a general portal that is developing for a general government tech.
Okay.
Right.
Okay, fantastic. Thank you for your time. Since we have only 3 minutes, I will go through this relatively quickly. There are the slides. This is an actual product. And I'm going to do two things here. I'm first going to show you what that we are doing for the data for the initiative. So, City Dash, which is our platform, provides insights about people. And we define the as three things: people patterns, people activity, and people movement. And we were working in the top of Italy in February. We had many customers there. And we realized that COVID was growing in Italy. And that's how we got into the initiative that we were having. So the first campaign that we provided that was called Desert. And now you can see that that has expanded to a whole bunch of people. We announced, so we have Italy, Spain, Thailand, New York, and Korea in the US. Later, Indonesia, India, Canada, Mexico, we are heading Brazil this week, Singapore, and so that will be a little bit of good. I'm going to go through the video and then I will put the time. So, when you can speak, there are a couple of things here. One is providing the Italian government with a sense of our movement across their cities, across their regions, in their provinces. So the first view we have here is movement across cities. This color gives you movement across the top of the cities, town, and metro area in this. What does that mean? It means that you can collect any of the details and just sort of pick one part here that's home and Tanzania. If you wanted to know how many from Tanzania are missing, the answer is 4.5. If you want to see the number of people from Rome, that would be Tanzania. From Rome to Tanzania, that is 1.8%. And this is for the company. And you could literally click on the top of this major, and we would give you the movement that bi-directional movement that occurred between Rome to city in the majors. You could also click on this blue line that goes down the middle, and that line represents the number of people that stayed within the city, or has been, the people that didn't have to, which is an important metric when you're looking at movement control. How many people live outside the city, that is measured by the movement. So, who started providing these measurements to the Italian government for two reasons? One is so that they could prepare for movement-based COVID propagation. So for example, if you see heavy movement in this place behind Rome, and let's say some reason Rome has a large cluster of COVID cases, you know then that because of this heavy movement, you might see the cases that are likely to be across these two cities. So the first thing to find in this country is the rate of movement of people and therefore what might have gotten in the COVID case. The second part of it was law enforcement or moving people. If you have enforcement control in a certain country or in a country, you want to know if people are moving in and out, how do you measure the effectiveness of the movement? So this was part of the game. And so that is often given in this visualization giveaway to my role, and we can import the things that make your movement from movement. And this is a bit for all of the data. So let's just follow and see how many questions we have done to Taiwan and other.
Would you want to scroll down a bit the presentation that you're showing?
Any questions at all?
Yeah, a few questions, yes. So your signals are, if I understand incorrectly, please correct me. So your signals are done by integrating from the SDKs that are crowdsourced in essence. Through various like Wi-Fi, GPS, or whatever modalities, right? So the movement patterns that you track are actually a certain film, right? A certain application level view of the film. So if the film like has multiple NOx sandboxes, or that the film has a root mode. That allows it to basically service as different phones and so on. How deep are you in integrating into the phone level, like directly through the IMEI or directly through other vicinity to relocate the actual phone, or do you just trust whatever the phone is telling you?
Apple, can you hear us?
Is the sound getting through, or?
Sorry, at what point did we get disconnected?
Okay, so you cannot hear me. Is my sound not getting through?
No, it's getting through yet, but
Okay, so my question is really simple. So this is not, so by crowdsourcing. Do you mean the user actively look at the data that is sent you and correct the inaccuracies, or is it a purely passive collection that trusts whatever the phone tells you, but the user has no way to correct it. That's the essence of my question.
This is at the data collection that is happening in the program and the program. So we work with over 10,000 apps and games and Google apps essentially to collect data on a normal basis. So we have a significant data stream that is continuously streaming into our tablet. And that is essentially how we are going to do to provide movement insights, both for municipalities, for COVID propagation purposes, or law enforcement mental limits.
Yeah, I'm aware of that. Sorry. I'm not asking about that part. I'm asking that as a person that is being tracked by your platform, do I have a portal where I can see how exactly I'm being tracked and correct or curate your data if somehow the data goes wrong because of poor reception or other technical issues? That is to say, do you have a view designed for the user to control their own data, or this is entirely passive and the user is essentially, there's no way for the user to be aware of it? That's the core of my question.
The user is aware in the sense that, let's say you have an app on your phone, that app will go to game, because that app is for navigating or for finding a restaurant or going out to dinner, local search. So you provide your location to the app, and we are analyzing SDK with the app, and so we get the geolocation data, which we analyze and provide back to the app in terms of insight. In return, get an optimized data. So this is a system that you provide an app developer and app developer throughout the world. And in the process, we get an optimized geolocation data from a developer data. This means that the end user, the consumer, is aware that they are sharing the location in the app because you have to do the location commitment and you have to access the security. But they don't have a portal with in and look at their data and control their data. So that is something that we are holding a significant amount of data in those countries and those cities. You could put in the add-on protocol that allows you as an end user to view your own data.
Yeah, I see that. So basically what you're saying is that this is a consent and aggregation platform where the user gives consent and you only deal with data in the aggregate, and it is forced to the data collectors to share controllership with data to users, but you are not explicitly managing that relationship. That's my understanding from your response.
You are exactly.
Okay, thank you. Please.
We should do a quick review because I have a shared theme. It did not go so well. Let me just do something quick. Is my thing on Google Maps?
Yes.
Sure. We're seeing your screen.
Okay, very good. I'm going to log in here. And
so just to ask, are you looking for more like from the user standpoint, like if we can sort of interact or so as well to...
Because at the moment, only thing we're enforcing is, not really enforcing, recommending is social distancing.
Right.
We're not recommending anything else now.
Right.
And that's the voluntary participation fact.
Right.
It really doesn't make sense for you to retroactively penalize people who didn't observe social distancing. I mean, it's not a very good use of aggregate data. at that level, I think it's exactly the same as 1968.
Right.
Each of little box.
Yes.
But each of little box has finer granularity.
Right.
And so I'm just trying to see that whether there could be a kind of user joint controllership view of this thing, because there's sometimes ask of each of little box that if I can just crowdsource my reports and so on. But
right,
it doesn't seem like that's. I mean, this seems to operate exactly in the same as the each of little box level.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's hard to see how to use this to augment or to supplement each other.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm still trying to think through the scenarios.
Yeah, I was also thinking of the other sites. I use Ijoloba these days, and actually sometimes they're still not covering the whole, you know, regions. Still limited in some regions. But it's actually, for me, it's actually quite user-oriented, like quite, you know, citizens-oriented. Yeah. Like I could actually see, you know, like if I want to go somewhere or want to, you know, to look for more supplies, it's more user-oriented than, let's say, corporate or from the government side-oriented. So I was thinking City Dash or the Data Protection Project is even more from, you know, the cross-border perspective instead of from the user, because Ijoloba has been actually quite successful on that part.
Yeah.
So maybe for a good site, we can provide more data, you know, from either travelers or just any people who are crossing the
borders. Yeah, but the thing is that these are aggregate data, as he shared. So what we want, if we want to lift the traveling ban, is individual level data, like whether they are RT-PCR tested, whether they're rapid tested, and so on, and not these movement pattern data, which is, frankly speaking, less indicative of the potential risk.
Sure.
We would much rather that they just go through RT-PCR.
Sure.
I'm being very frank, but this is amazing technology. I'm just trying to fit a scenario.
Right, makes sense. Yeah, do you want to add some more here?
Yeah, to show you the seven in the meetup in
Yeah, I see that.
Yeah, what you see here is the heat map of actual heat angles in different parts of the cities.
Yes.
So as I click around, we are showing you the number of posts that we in each part. We are showing you a trend by the hour day.
Yes.
So what will be count by from what we have in the evening and night and by day of the week. And you can look at the actual impacts of that looks like. And you can even ask the question, where did they come from? Because this is another thing that we are providing to almost every government that is interested in the food case. So though this aggregate data, it is aggregated over a specific time window. And what that allows us to do is run the destination. So in this case, if you know where the people come from, to that red long and middle, we can give you a improved analysis. And you can see that with the height arrows and the numbers connecting all these different logs. And you can increase that to, let's say, a over 40 connect, and now you know all the different logs that make the map back to that main. The use case here is, that our city had five total factors. And you wanted us to give you a sense for personal movement across Taipei City and how to move from that block to all the other blocks. Granted, based on how you get data, probably represent 29 to 32%, I think, around in that range for the population. It still gives you a very strong sense for how it's moving from the curve. There might be a high percentage of case now in the future.
Okay, thank you. Very good visualization. Really like the way that it shows almost like a airport and flight spike and hub model. I really loved this visualization. So thank you for the demo. We were just chatting kind of on the site track, but I'll share what we were chatting with you. In Taiwan, there is an app called 1968 that shows pretty much exactly the same heat map based on telecommunication tower data. That's triangulation data. So it's not as precise as GPS by design. It's the resolution is maybe just 50 meters. But because it's coming straight from a telecom company and they don't have even an opt-out process, this is because they're dealing with statistics, they don't ask for consent, and there is no, you can opt out, but there really is no consent process. Of course, we're looking at alternatives or things that could complement that application, but because at the moment, the only thing that we're implementing here is social distancing. And so it's unclear how a finer resolution will help us. So I'm being very frank with you. If we are having community spread, then of course having a finer resolution helps a lot because that helps contact tracing.
but at the moment there is no community cases for the past months. So at the moment, the only thing is social distancing, at which case 50 meters resolution is good enough, is as good as any if you're just doing hotspot analysis. And so I'm just trying to think through how your amazing technology can be used, but at the moment I'm trying to find with some scenarios and then couldn't quite get the scenario in the GovTech part. But thank you for the demo, it is a really good demo.
Many of the companies that we work with at FDA, the local health, not all of them, local health, are providing data services. But they are providing collaboration. In their case, it is still at 100 meter resolution. They are not even making 50 meter resolution. Yeah. 50, that's pretty good.
Yeah. I see that.
But the telephone, you are going to get a version of the data from that. Unless you are able to all tell those to come together and work together, you're not going to get a complete picture. The same thing with us, we're going to get a complete picture. You're working with apps, and apps are like the main app. You're going to get a more diverse view.
Yeah, I see that. Yes, I agree. I agree. I see that. All right, thank you for the demo. I don't have any other questions. This is really pretty good technology. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I guess maybe you can share more on the link of the demo or more case studies that could be applied to Taiwan later through email.
Sure. And just so you know that we're putting up this video conference to YouTube as well. And so if there's more commercial sector people or social sector people who want to use this technology, I'll also just direct them directly to you. Thank you.
Oh, that's great. We don't want to design this for code. We are...
Yeah.
If they were paying for code, we are working with municipalities and government entities.
Yeah.
For quantity, I can use it.
Yeah, I think like any large tourism agency or business owner of a tourism package company may be a better fit. But I really appreciate the demo. It's a really good demo. Thank you.
Okay,
fantastic.
Okay, bye. Bye. Bye for now.
谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢，谢谢 needs、嗯、那在美国他们现在也不是真的有那个人潮预测的需求
OK
所以现在这个需要 very very limited
那有做就是就像说 social distancing 的控管就是比如说、如果、就是事后或是评估说 OK 不管现在我们开始、reactivate 这些活动啊那这些 community 它怎么去除了预测之外跟
就是反向的
tracing 啊对就是
像新加坡他们是那叫 trace together 嘛、嗯、那澳洲也有英国现在在小岛上测试那台湾是、就是 AI Labs、有做一个也是、就是 Bluetooth based、
okay.
对那但是这些都是就是 user curated 然后是 anonymity preserving、嗯、那所以跟他的技术是有互补之处但像 AI Labs 弄那个它也是 source code 然后甚至他们就说那英国如果要用 source code 就交给英国去用那主要原因是因为英国现在状态是比较需要的、嗯、而台湾就毫无用处、嗯、所以目前啊、嗯、要是有用处的话我们更大的问题但是我们回到社区传播阶段但是在台湾其实
当然是希望以预防的
角度对台湾事实上没有到过社区传播阶段
对
所以我们现在的 contact tracing主要原因是还是因为我们戴口罩的那个就是 R 值很低、嗯、就是大家都戴口罩
对对对
那在这种情况下你 enforce social distancing 尤其是在户外、嗯、其实就是大概就是看到一公尺没有人就口罩就脱下来也还好
对
我们不会觉得说这样情况下你还要特别去 sign 一个 app
去确保说一公尺外这个如果有人以后确诊了一定要通知我，因为我们现在社区就真的还蛮安全的。
对，
但是这一类的 app 就是说你要足够多的人 sign up in它才开始有作用。
对，它其实比较偏跟 B2B 啦，它没有，就像你提到，它比较不是 user rate 的，因为它是跟不管 telco 啦，跟这些 operator 直接合作的，
对，
所以它拿到这些 data 是直接透过当地的。
但在台湾做法比较奇怪，就是中华电信开发了一套算法，
对，
然后它交给五大电信，包括它自己。然后分别运行这个算法，就是 proximity analysis。所以在这个情况下，如果所有的电信都已经合作了，那 app level 能够做的是非常有限。
OK， 所以我们比较不会需要到可能其他 region 的，比如说电信的 data 来 support。
主要的原因就是因为台湾你很难 accidentally 到台湾。就是说当然有少数地方你可以同时收到两个 jurisdiction 的电信啊，好比像说什么石原岛啊或者是金门啊，就是说这个是很 edge case 的，
主要还是在这个 region 里面，
对，非常 edge case 的东西，所以我们就是我们自己这边的 telco 加上边境的筛检，
对，
那还有 home quarantine 就 digital fence、
okay.
那这三个其实这样一家好像就中间那种就是漏网之鱼就很少，
对，
没有多大，
还没有到那么大的，
足以大家需要靠 GPS
跨境这样 tracking 到底有没有需要？
因为你不会
到底
有少心到，当然希望我们不需要啊，只是说有没有可能说之后 travel ban 解就是
对，但解开了50号他来以前 PCR
就是有
这种方式
做精准，
对，就是直接看他有没有
要 enforce，
对，当然更好就是他有抗体了，他已经免疫了，那随便了，
对，
他来就随便走吧，
对。好，那我最后也帮其他我们的家族朋友们要提前也问一下，那如果以 COVID-19 这个现在您在做的这些 initiative， 会比较想再造哪一个方向的
COHAP 的题目啊？
就是哦，所以就是完全连接到 COHAP，
对。我们之前来许愿的就是不管我们 CECC 的或者是美国那边 CDC 的专家，我们都是导引到 COHAP， 所以你在上面看到这六类的子题已经是就是大家已经确保说就是你解它也不会违法，然后就是显或不显然会违法，对，然后在台美都至少有一边会愿意 adopt 的这样子的一个强度，
对，
所以就是你就看 COHAP 就好了。
OK， 那是今天截止
对吗？对，今天截止。就你看到如果有刚好 match 就请他们送一件，
对，
那有的话之后还会有。但是方向就是这些了。
对 ，OK， 了解。好，那如果说之后你这里有别的initiative project， 欢迎。
如果总统没得送啊，大家可以上去投票。
OK，
然后你也可以就是自主的加入团队，等20强出来了，你觉得20强里面有一些是你真的可以帮忙的，你就直接进他们团队，也是很好的。
是 ，OK。
好，再感谢，
好，
谢谢，
谢谢。